Welcome, everyone, to this afternoon's program on the remarkable film, Winter Journey. My name is Dina Hirsch, I'm Vice President of the Generations After. It is my distinct honor to introduce our moderator, Bob Edwards, and to welcome our distinguished speakers, Martin Goldsmith and Anders Ostergaard. Many of us have read Martin's riveting book, The Inextinguishable Symphony, upon which the film is based. And many of us heard Martin discuss this unique story of love, music, and harrowing escape when he spoke to the Generations After a number of years ago. Little did we know then that his book would inspire an internationally acclaimed film. Today, we are privileged to hear a conversation between Martin and Anders, the film's distinguished Danish filmmaker, moderated by Peabody Award-winning broadcast journalist Bob Edwards. Bob was the first host of NPR's Morning Edition, a position he held for 24 years. With his authoritative and reassuring voice and outstanding journalistic skills, Bob made Morning Edition the second highest rated radio broadcast in the country. Having conducted 20,000 interviews on NPR, Bob has covered a vast range of topics over the years. And we are truly fortunate to have him bring his extraordinary skills to our program this afternoon. At the conclusion of the discussion, the speakers will take as many questions as possible. So please post your questions to the chat box as you think of them. For those of you who did not have a chance to view the film, Venemsha Films has graciously extended our viewing period through tomorrow. You will use the same link and password that were sent to you, and these are listed below in the chat. We will also be posting a recording of this program on YouTube in a few days, and we'll provide a link for all of you. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Bob Edwards.
Well, thank you very much. So much a pleasure to be part of this program and to be here with these two very, very fine artists. We have a stimulating and fascinating conversation ahead. Martin, Anders, and I will engage in a discussion about the film, Winter Journey, how it emerged from Martin's book, the background of the Judischer Culturbund, and its significance, the unusual documentary drama methodology that Anders employs so brilliantly, and go down any other paths that our discussion might take us. And then we'll turn to your questions and get to as many as we can. We're all in for a very rich afternoon. Martin Goldsmith is a longtime friend, very dear colleague. It's a producer, announcer, and program director at WETA-FM in Washington, D.C. for many years before becoming music producer and senior commentator at NPR. There he hosted the program Performance Today for 10 years. He is currently classical music director at Sirius XM Satellite Radio, where his distinctive voice and commentary can be heard on Sirius XM's Symphony Hall channel. He has sung in opera choruses, acted on Washington area stages, and had music reviews in the Washington Post. And if that's not a true measure of a Renaissance man, he has authored three books, of which two chronicle his family's story in Nazi Germany. That third book is about the Beatles. So, you know, this man loves all kinds of music.
He has taste.
Anders Ostergaard is an internationally renowned Danish documentary filmmaker who makes his second home in Berlin. He graduated from the Danish School of Media and Journalism and has gone on to create a distinctive body of films. His approach is both observational and expository and draws on a mix of archival material and new recordings, which is very much the style of Winter Journey. It has been said that Anders combines a sense of documentary authenticity with psychological intimacy, an award-winning combination. His film Burma Vijay, reporting from a closed country, received an Oscar nomination and a record-breaking number of international awards. In 2015, he was awarded the Danish Dreyer Award in recognition of his extraordinary contributions to the Danish film industry. Winter Journey represents his interest in the question of how and at what price cultural minority groups retain their identity while trying to integrate into the greater society. Welcome to both of you. Martin, explain the Culturbund, which was not just your parents' temporary refuge, it's where they met.
First of all, thanks to Generations After, and thanks, Bob, for that generous introduction. Yes, the Judischer Culturbund was a remarkable organization. When Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of Germany in January of 1933, the Nazis had many things on their plate, many things they hoped to accomplish. But one of the very first things they did was to evict Jewish artists from their positions with German opera companies, theater companies, and orchestras. So that by the early spring of 1933, there were thousands of unemployed Jewish artists across Germany. And they decided that if they could no longer make art for their fellow Germans, they could make art for their fellow German Jews. So they created this organization made up of formerly very high-placed actors, musicians, dancers, and the like. And they came together and chose a man by the name of Kurt Singer to be their director. He had been the conductor of Berlin Opera before January of 1933. He quickly realized that the Kulturbund probably would not get anywhere without official Nazi sanction. And he went knocking on various doors in the Nazi hierarchy, and he came upon a man named Hans Hinkel, who was second in command to Dr. Joseph Goebbels, in what was known as the Ministry for Public Enlightenment and Propaganda. And both Herr Hinkel and Dr. Goebbels realized that this could be very beneficial to them as a propaganda tool. They reasoned that if any countries around the world began to object to the stories coming out of Germany about how the Jews were being treated, they could say, well, look, they have their own opera company, their own theater company. All these rumors you're hearing are just that, rumors and nothing to take seriously. So the Kulturbund began in October of 1933 with a play called Nathan der Weise, Nathan the Wise, by Gotthold Lessing. And over the next several years, there were many Kulturbund branch offices, aside from the head office in Berlin. There was one in Frankfurt. My mother, aged 18 at the time, auditioned for the Kulturbund and was accepted by a conductor by the name of Hans Wilhelm Steinberg. He later changed his name to William Steinberg, emigrated to this country, and was the music director in Buffalo, Pittsburgh, and Boston. But back in 1935, it was my mother's good fortune to be accepted into the Kulturbund. My father was 22 years old at the time, and he was getting ready to emigrate to Sweden after the Nuremberg Laws were enacted in September of 35. But before he could move, the phone rang in his apartment in Karlsruhe, and a man at the end of the phone asked if he could join the Kulturbund for a couple of performances. Their principal flutist had gotten sick. And so my father threw a few things into a suitcase, took the train from Karlsruhe up to Frankfurt, and then duly moved to Sweden. But he couldn't forget the lovely young violist he had met during those rehearsals and concerts. And so he chose to remain in Germany to be with the woman who would become his wife and my mother. That's a thumbnail sketch of the Kulturbund.
You put this all in your book, The Inextinguishable Symphony, very much still in print, Amazon shoppers. And the title refers to the last work that your parents performed as members of the Kulturbund, a work composed by a Dane.
Exactly. They actually never had a chance to perform the Inextinguishable Symphony, that they rehearsed it because my parents got out of Germany literally just in time. They landed on Ellis Island 80 years ago this week on June 22nd, 1941. Mm-hmm. And by the time the next season of the Culturbund was to have begun, the Culturbund was dissolved in September of 1941. And everyone who had not managed to escape Germany by then was sent to the camps. But yes, the Inextinguishable Symphony, a magnificent symphony by the Danish composer Carl Nielsen, was to have been performed. And it just, given the power of the music and the story behind the music, it seemed like an apt title. And then, yes, there is that Danish connection, the way things move in mysterious ways.
Another Dane has picked up the story. Anders, how did you come to this story, and what made you think that this could be a film?
Being bored in an airport is where the story begins, because I was looking for something to read on the plane, came across a book on the persecution of Jews in general in the 30s, and thought, well, I think I heard most about as much as I can about it, but then, sitting in that plane, I came across two lines that describe this Kulturbund phenomenon. And I was intrigued, curious about what happened there when I realized the awkward setup that was behind it, as it being in effect controlled by Goebbels. Mm-hmm. And so I just pursued this subject out of curiosity. And very also soon, I must say, also find, even before getting across Martin's book, I was also intrigued because even back in Denmark, I had been fascinated by the kind of crypto-Jewish existence of many families, including my own, in fact. My mother has a Jewish line of family, but it's never discussed. It is, I wouldn't call it a taboo. It's just not considered worth discussing. It's kind of curiosity at most, but there's nothing worthwhile discussing. And this is for years I've been circling around this issue. Why have the Jewish community so broadly in Denmark chosen to actually underplay their identity as Jewish people? And so I found some similarities in this whole situation we find in 1933 with the foundation of the Kulturbund and the eagerness of those Jewish musicians to be respected as German, as part of German cultural life. And this intriguing point was further reinforced when I came across Martin's book, of course. Not only was it very well written and a fantastic story in itself, but also intrigued by the Martin's dad, George's stubborn insistence that he was a German above all, and his Jewishness was irrelevant. This actually draws the lines to many debates we have ongoing hot debates we're having in Europe at the moment, at least, on the question of integration and even assimilation.
And you came upon the structure of the conversation between Martin and his father.
We kind of explored this quite soon, as I recall it. Martin and I explored the background for the book. I realized that there must have been some interesting conversations going on. And if we were able to dig into those conversations, we would also be able to unfold another aspect of this thing, which is the generational aspect. How a third or second or third generation tries to deal with the past or tries to investigate the past. And it's obvious that the case of the Goldsmiths and the silence of the family there and the many taboos and the non-discussion of the past is something that is very broadly known, both sides of the Atlantic, and is an intriguing issue, a topic in itself, how generations sort themselves out in this matter.
Yeah, and I saw it again last night, and I was watching very closely, trying to pick up your tricks, the zealot quality of dropping people into archival still photographs and film is just amazing.
Well, thank you. It's a very intuitive way of working for me. It comes, I guess, out of fascination of found footage, as is that somehow always had an attraction to me. And of course, the documentary quality of instead of building your own sets that actually make use of real existing buildings. A very good case in point is the original Gestapo headquarters in Prince Albrechtstrasse, in Berlin, which of course doesn't exist anymore. It was bombed flat long ago, but there was these pictures around, and when we realized we were able to put our character into that building and walk those stairs, I felt this would actually just much more intriguing than trying to find something similar and make it look alike.
You used color for present day, black and white for the 30s.
Yes, I guess, of course. But that actually springs out of necessity that on the kind of, this is black and white material, so we stay in that. In order to integrate our characters fully, they, of course, should also be black and white. But we get that extra quality to it, that we have that distinct difference between the two periods in time.
And Bruno Ganz, how did you get him? He is the star of this thing and just a magnificent actor.
Well, that was amazing. It wasn't too complicated, but I had the good fortune that his agent had seen some of my earlier work. I don't think Bruno ever knew of it, but she did. And she was very insistent that he should read the script. And it was just a lucky punch that he happened to be very interested in the question of the fate of the Jews in the 30s and 40s. Maybe being from Switzerland, where this is also a delicate subject that he felt was maybe not dealt with enough. He had a lifelong fascination for the Jewish tradition in Europe in general, and of course, in particular, the Holocaust and what happened around there. I had no idea that he would have that special interest. So just a fortunate coming together of things.
You must be very convincing, Martin. You told me that at times you felt you were talking to your father.
It was really extraordinary. When I met Bruno Ganz in Tucson, where all of the exterior shots were made, in January of 2018, I fully expected that he would take me by the arm and lead me off into a corner somewhere and quiz me about various physical aspects of my father, how he spoke, the rhythm of his speech, whether he smoked a pipe, things like that. But in fact, he wanted nothing whatsoever to do with any of that. He created his character based solely on the script and his genius as an actor. But yes, there are times watching the film, there are moments when he really embodies my father in an almost eerie fashion. There's that one scene where he describes his conversation with his landlord, a fellow by the name of Adolf Cohen. And Mr. Cohen apparently would leave a suitcase by the door. And my father once asked him, why do you have that suitcase? And Adolf Cohen said, well, I want to be able to take something along when the Gestapo comes for me. And my father said, what are you talking about? And Adolf Cohen says, haven't you heard? We're all going to be burned. And my father said, oh, those are rumors and fairy tales, to which Adolf Cohen said, you will remember, Adolf Cohen. And I remember those words exactly as spoken to me by my father telling me that story. And every time we get to that moment in the film, I really have to remind myself that it's not Günter Goldschmidt speaking to me, the man I knew as George Goldsmith, but the great Bruno Ganz. He's embodied my father in so many ways.
Anders, did he know it was going to be his final role?
No, he didn't. I have no reason to think so. He already, only on the set did he start to have issues, health issues that he hadn't experienced before. And only later was he diagnosed with very serious cancer. I think he was at least not conscious of it. You never know, however, if intuitively there's a feeling that it's getting tight, and that there was hanging over the set was a very focused mood, which I think could suggest that he had a feeling that he has to make an effort here because it might. So even though I have no reason reason to factually know anything, you know, there was a sense of making, and this has to be made right because it might not be another occasion.
A little postscript. He was performing at the Salzburg Festival in Austria in the summer of 2018, and he was taken ill. He had to leave the production that he was a part of. He went home to Zurich, and though very ill in, I guess it was late September of 18, honors, he welcomed you and your sound team into his home so that he could record those telephone calls and the final bits of his contribution to the film. So he obviously, even sick as he was, he wanted to complete his work.
He had plenty of strength for this film. There's that scene where he, as George, your father, is describing his visit to the Gestapo headquarters to get passports stamped so they could leave Germany. And he mimics the Gestapo official who's calling him a filthy Jewish Schwein. And it's scary. And one critic said he thought that Bruno was channeling his earlier role as Hitler in Downfall. Some powerful, powerful action there.
Yes, it's an extraordinary moment. And again, it's straight out of what my father told me, that you know, this Nazi official, Gestapo official, yelled at him for tracking rain into his nice, clean office. And for a moment, he thought he'd screwed everything up and that the Gestapo guy would tear up the visas and the passports. But luckily, he stamped them with the official stamps, and my father beat a hasty retreat out of Gestapo headquarters.
I'm trying to imagine being an artist growing up in Western Europe with this dark, looming history. Is the Holocaust a theme an artist must inevitably address, or is it something one tries to resist to avoid comparison with other artists' treatments?
I think you're right. If you take an interest, as I do so much, in the 20th century in general, this is a topic you have to find a way to address it some way or the other. Because in so many other films I made, there is something pointing to this issue. There are references to this. It's kind of always in the background. Mm. So I cannot say I purposefully went to do that. It's kind of things, I just took an interest and things developed and Martin's book and so on, and suddenly I found myself in it. But I felt it was right I was in a way happy to have been given this opportunity to approach the subject, also to approach in a new way, because I felt very much that the portrait of Jews and Nazis and the whole Second World War, or the broad persecution story, tended to have ended up in, if you like, in a Polish Russian or Russian village with the little Orthodox man crawling around the street and the big German yelling at him as if these people were ethnically so utterly distinct. It's like two different species of mankind. Yeah. And that's true in some cases, can't be perceived at this way if you go to certain environments. But if you go to Germany, where the whole thing started, it could be very hard. It was often very rather impossible to tell a Jew from a non-Jew. Them all being Germans, by the way, and this was just the Jew and Gentile thing was not something you could easily point out always. It had to be invented first in a way, as things had developed in Germany. So I felt also quite keen to give alternate images of the persecution, other ideas of how it went on and how people cope with it.
So many things to confront here. Martin, you found a document that recorded your father's bar mitzvah, and it knocked you down. It amazed you. Why is that?
We grew up, my brother and I, in a family that was certainly totally Jewish by any definition. My father's family were Jews. His grandfather's name was Moses Goldschmidt. His great-grandfather's name was Levi Goldschmidt. My mother was an only child, but both of her parents were Jews. And my parents played in this all-Jewish orchestra called the Judischer Culturbund. And yet my father insisted that we were not Jews. He said we were of Jewish background, or he once used the phrase, we are so-called Jews. So yes, you could have knocked me over with a feather when doing research in the archives in Oldenburg, I came upon, with the help of the archivists, this document which showed that Gunther Ludwig Goldschmidt, aged 13, was bar mitzvahed in the spring of 1926, the year he indeed turned 13. And I remember in Oldenburg getting on the phone and calling my father in Tucson and saying, I found your bar mitzvah record, and he claimed not to remember it. And I cannot imagine anyone forgetting that they had a bar mitzvah, but my father was so intent on denying the fact that he was a Jew. I think it had much to do with the guilt he felt having lost his family, feeling that he could have done something perhaps to ameliorate their fate. But for whatever reason, he insisted that he was not Jewish. So yes, the bar mitzvah story was quite a surprise to him and to me.
Did you say Hitler made him a Jew?
Yes, Hitler decided I was a Jew and I choose not to be, he said.
But it's just the idea of denial. If he's not Jewish, what is this about?
He was German. He saw the Nazis as invaders. They occupied the country from 1933 until 1945. And they were the outsiders. He carried the torch of the true faith of being German. But there was also, I can only imagine, an element of fear. And there was a moment that Honoris and I sort of struggled with, asked whether we would include this moment in the film. And evidently, or not, eventually we decided it wouldn't fit. But in his later years, my father was afflicted with Alzheimer's, and he was living in an Alzheimer's facility in Rockville, Maryland, not too far from my house. And I would visit him several times a week. And one warm summer's day, I reached in my T-shirt drawer and pulled up the T-shirt that was on top of the pile and threw it on without thinking and went off to see him. And I walked into his room and he gasped and he said, "You're wearing that?" And my T-shirt simply said, "Jewish Book Fair." I had gotten a T-shirt from a Jewish book fair somewhere in California. And he was absolutely appalled that I would wear this shirt out in public, you know, proclaiming myself to be a Jew. So he obviously, in his experience, of course, to be a Jew was to be condemned, and he wanted nothing of it.
Your mother in America enjoyed a wonderful career with the St. Louis and Cleveland symphonies. Your father sold furniture.
Yes, in 1946, my mother auditioned for the St. Louis Symphony Orchestra and she was accepted. And my father joined the staff of Famous Bar, a famous department store. So famous, in fact, that Amanda Wingfield demonstrates brassieres in Famous Bar as told by Tennessee Williams in his play, The Glass Menagerie. My father worked at the real Famous Bar selling furniture. And I think it's no coincidence that 1946, when the first grisly newsreels began to emerge as the camps were liberated in the East. And though my father would not find out all the details until a number of years later, having requested the International Red Cross look into things for him. He knew that his family, no doubt, had perished. And in fact, his father and younger brother were murdered in Auschwitz. His mother and younger sister were murdered in a forest outside of Riga, Latvia. And my belief is that my father gave up his life as a musician in an act of penance for failing to save his family.
Anders, you with great sensitivity, show the guilt that that George felt at not being able to help his father and his brother. And they would write him letters that frankly inflicted guilt upon him. And he shows these letters to Martin in the film.
Yeah, this is the rosebud, the secret, the truth that is held back for the entire film and only revealed at the last minute, still based very much on real events and how it was. And it is, I'm glad this point comes through. There has been members of the audience who didn't quite catch that correlation. I hope it's obvious to more than yourself that there is the key to what made George give up a musical career, or actually having a life at all in the way I perceive it, after the fate of his family.
How's the film being received?
Well, it has been received by the monster of Corona, to be honest. We had 2 weeks of a very promising premiere in Germany, which has been the most successful, most vibrant territory for the film has been Germany itself, where it's been received very warmly. And had we then been able to continue for more than those 2 weeks we were allowed until restrictions closed the cinemas, I think it would become grown into a very big thing indeed, actually. It seems that the Germans felt that there was a way they could approach this topic in a new way. And I'm very happy that that's the way it is perceived. So it is clear and distinct that Germany is the country that has given this film the most attention.
Martin, I would suspect you're pleased by it all.
Well, yes, the reception is wonderful. I'm disappointed, of course, in the C-19 and its effect on this film, but of course, what did Mr. Bogart say? Problems of one author doesn't amount to a hill of beans in this crazy world. Amidst all the death and destruction of COVID, I certainly can't complain. But I'm hoping that once things return to normal, the film will reach a wider audience here in this country. But I'm so thrilled at the film that exists, and all praise to Anders for his vision. And I publicly want to say thank you again to Anders.
What challenges did you have, Anders, in bringing this story to the screen?
Of course, all you can think of is the usual challenges of financing it at all and making it physically possible and getting Bruno flown to Arizona without too much trouble and all that is what you remember is all the practical issues. If I try to think back on the creative challenges, it would probably most be how to be able to discuss this topic with any kind of leisure. Because as you can see, my style is playful, basically, essentially playful. And even you could say, I'm looking for the word now, not decadent, but the word awaits me at the moment. But frivolous. Frivolous is what sometimes people have called my way of working, my style, in my very liberal approach to the application of archive materials and so on. And could I, with my instinctive way of working, address such a serious topic without abusing it, basically? And I'm very relieved to see that it seems that people can take laughter with tears or appreciate a more, what should I say, playful or at least imaginative approach to cinema, even with this great topic. I'm still quite mystery to me, actually, that I could get away with that, and that there is, that this is possible in cinema without, you know, reducing the importance of the subject, banalizing anything, hopefully.
The conversations between you and your father, Martin, it's, at times it seems you're angry. It's, I imagine it's really frustration, not anger.
Well, it's a combination of many ingredients, Bob. Given the fact that my father gave up his life as a musician, caused him a great deal of pain and anger, I'm sure. He was something of a martinet in the household. I mean, if we were supposed to leave the house at 7 o'clock to attend one of my mother's concerts, we would, by God, leave at 7, not at 7:01, not at 30 seconds after 7 o'clock, but at 7 on the dot. And fathers and sons always have their issues. But there was a part of me that certainly comes out in the towards the very end of the film, where I am overcome with a combination of frustration and anger and pity for this man who sort of canceled the second part of his life over this tragedy over which he had no control. And in that scene that leads to my father, Bruno, giving me the letters from the family, in that scene, I am trying to get him to acknowledge that he could have done something other than sell furniture and attend sales meetings with their, you know, phony slogans and so on and so forth. He could have taught music. He could have played chamber music with friends, but he took his flute and literally put it up into the closet on a high shelf. And that scene is me just overcome with anger at him and also on his behalf and pity for him. And it just, I think it was very much a depiction of a real emotion, which I still maintain to a certain degree to this day.
When did you first start asking these questions?
Not till I was about 40.
Really?
Yeah. I remember my brother once asked my father, how come all of our friends go over the river and through the woods to grandmother's house at Thanksgiving? Where are our grandmothers? Where are our grandfathers? Where are our aunts and uncles? And my father's response was, they died in the war. That was it. And as I write in the book, when we four gathered at dinner, we never talked about what had happened to the family. We never talked about what happened in Nazi Germany. Not, I write, for any reasons of our being shushed or censored. It was just a topic that didn't exist. It was like discussing bauxite mining in Peru. There was no reason to talk about what had happened in Germany. Then when I entered my 40s, I happened to be traveling in Europe, and my father was in Europe, and we met in Oldenburg, his hometown, and he showed me where his father's store had been, and he showed me the beautiful house where he had lived. And slowly, all of these things came together, and he visited me in Washington in 1994, the year the Holocaust Museum opened, and he agreed to come with me to one of the very first showings of the Holocaust Museum. And I mentioned that to a colleague of yours and mine, Alex Chadwick, and Alex brought along a microphone and recorded my father's reaction to the Holocaust Museum, and then recorded an interview with my father at NPR, and the produced a feature for Morning Edition. And my father began receiving all manner of responses from around the country, from people fascinated by his story and expressing their support for him and his life. And that, I think, began opening him up a bit more. And that's when these serious conversations between him and me began.
Were you trying to sound younger in the film?
Not consciously, but I guess there is definitely a difference. Well, and part of that I attribute to Unearth's really great direction when I'm doing the narration parts. He really wanted me to be slow and deliberate. And in the other part of the film, when I'm talking to my father, I'm a bit more animated, so I think I come across as younger. Did you think I sounded younger?
Did he become a prima donna, Unearth? Was he tough to work with? Was he a pain in the tuchus?
No, Martin was a sweetheart to work with. We've been so congenial about the whole thing from the beginning. The writing, just to have such a happy writing experience, of course, builds a mutual trust that you talk very closely about this as a how-to. It's not easy to play yourself, actually. Very impressed with Martin's performance. But I think it's very much because we built that trust and a very deep understanding, actually, about how to understand the film, the story, the characters. It was the pure joy, I must say. And as for Martin sounding younger, I think he was, I remember him as being totally going back to the times. What I recall from those sessions, that Martin was very much back there in the thing. Which is quite a journey to take when you're sitting in a cramped little audio studio and have to sync up to a screen and everything's artificial, but he managed nevertheless.
I think it also was a tribute to Bruno's ability to, as I say, embody my father. And if I'm sitting across from the image of the great Bruno Ganz as my dad, I sort of automatically, I think, lose a number of years and probably... Who knows how old I was in my head, but Bruno, I'm sure, contributed to what you saw.
He was fantastic. I was watching him very closely when I saw the film again last night, and what he does with his face, with his mannerisms, I mean, just an eyebrow, the way he swallows, I mean, I marvel at someone's gifts.
Sometimes so subtle that you don't even see them on set. You have to sit in the editing room. You're discovered, you know, 2 months later, what's actually going on. And that says a bit about his genius, that is about a hair raising an eyebrow for 2 millimeters and stuff like that. And in fact, it's something you only realize when you're cutting it. All he can do, the piano he is playing, in fact, in reality.
And for the most part, of course, he is a very serious character. There are a couple of times in the film when he smiles, and... The way he smiles is just, his entire face is transformed.
We promised members of the audience that they could ask questions, and those have been posted in the chat, and Mr. Edwards is going to look at them and pose them for our two guest speakers.
Martin, you have been back to Germany a number of times, to Oldenburg, to be in the house that was pretty much taken from your grandfather, was forced to sell it, has got to be, I can't imagine what emotions this would spur in you.
No, one of the times I was in Oldenburg, the people I was staying with received a phone call from the owners of the house on number 34 Gartenstrasse, where my father and his family lived, asking me if I wanted to come over and tour the house. And you're right, Bob, the emotions piled on top of each other like planes stacked up over O'Hare Airport. I was excited to be there. I was heartbroken to be there. Going out into the back garden, there was an old apple tree that I can only imagine what's growing when my father lived there. These people were kind enough to put up a plaque attached to the house explaining that Alex Goldschmidt and his wife and children lived there and that they were murdered by the National Socialists. And the film was actually shown in Germany for the first time in Oldenburg last year. And I was invited by the mayor to attend, but of course I couldn't because of the virus. But they're planning another such event later this year. And the beautiful Staatstheater, which one sees early in the film, where my father saw that production of Mozart's Magic Flute, which led him to be a flutist, that theater is going to be renaming one of its foyers as the Günter Goldschmidt Foyer, which is, I think, a wonderful honor done to my family.
I keep thinking, had the world turned out otherwise, you might have been living in that house as a lifelong German and in the ladies' garment business.
It's following my grandfather, yes. Or I could have been born in Sweden.
Right, right, where he was in refuge for a time.
Right.
When they joined the orchestra, your parents, how did their parents feel about their situation and what they were doing?
Well, my mother's father was a very well-known violinist and teacher. He ran his own conservatory in the German city of Düsseldorf. So I'm sure he was thrilled when Hans Wilhelm Steinberg asked his daughter to join the orchestra. My father's father, again, was a woman's clothing store owner. He was probably less interested in my father becoming a musician, but I'm sure he was very pleased. I mean, he was able to meet Rosemary, my mother. And so it was essentially just very good feelings across the board.
Was your mother any more forthcoming about the past than your father?
Well, she might have been, but alas, she died in 1984, a number of years before I began asking all of these questions. I think she would have remembered things my father didn't and would have had very interesting perspectives on various aspects of their life, but alas, she died too soon.
A question for both Anders and Martin. You mentioned the strong response for 2 weeks of the film in Germany before COVID hit. What accounts for that strong reception in Germany?
Well, it has a bit, I think, really truly to do with what I was discussing before, a shared sense of Germanness, that the Jewish tradition, the Jewish contribution to German culture is something very integrated. It's a silver line in the carpet, so to speak. And it's a silver line that has gone, silver thread, rather, that has gone missing and is missed, I think, in the spirit of German culture. It lacks a certain geist, as a spirit, certain chutzpah, maybe. I'm often reminded of that, what the non-presence of the Jewish thing. So it seems like an awkward family event for many Germans to watch this movie. Things that I could have not have known, I still don't quite fathom what's going on there, but it's really working.
I wonder about Germans today. I mean, Martin and I should both be Germans. Our ancestors are from there. Is there something called guilt fatigue? That they have carried this curse, their ancestors, for now two generations. And they could not possibly be responsible themselves, but they're a German.
I think there's not guilt fatigue, but there's a growing distance to the guilt as new generations grow up. So they're very much aware of that being part of their background. And they're no less serious about the subject. It's just that they have simply obviously less direct guilt, I feel, the younger generation. They can approach it in a different way. So I feel it's like, it's maybe an emotional slow fade out, but I don't think intellectually or kind of in terms of understanding what happened and the wish and the curiosity to understand, the wish to get to the depth of understanding is as strong as ever, if that makes any sense.
And I just would like to interject that it's been pointed out before, but in so many German cities, there are these little memorials called Stolpersteine, or stumble stones, where you will read that this Jewish family lived in this house before being deported to the East and murdered. There are Holocaust memorials in so many cities, big and small. There is the amazing Jewish Museum in Berlin, which, I mean, the architecture is one of the most powerful memorials. And it just seems to me that Germany has done such a far better job of coming to terms or trying to come to terms with the black mark next to its name in the book of history than the United States has when it comes to slavery and the annihilation of the Native American populations. But I do think that the US has something to learn from the way Germany has accepted and tried to come to terms with its past. Though I see your brow knit, honors.
Oh, I think you're making quite an effort at the moment. It seems to me that it's very much on top of the list of what people would be discussing in America and consequences being taken. I think you are exactly in the middle of that process, maybe with some delay, I guess 200 years. But I see more similarities, like you're dealing very much in depth with this issue. And I just don't think you have anything to regret vis-a-vis the Germans in this matter. It's just my impression of things from a distance.
But you know what? A piece of history bothered me. This has a happy ending. It's America welcomes your parents and gives them refuge, affords them a nice life and a career. But I read your other book about your grandfather and your uncle on the ship St. Louis, which was refused entry by, which carried hundreds and hundreds of refugees from, Jewish refugees from Europe, refused by Cuba, refused by my country, the United States, Canada, and on and on. And that's another part of our history that we have to account for. A shameful piece of history.
Yes, the St. Louis incident was one of the more shameful moments in American history. There was a famous political cartoon of the time by a man named Fred Packer in one of the New York newspapers. And it shows the St. Louis steaming by the Statue of Liberty and her torch is replaced by a sign that says, keep out.
Can I interject with a couple of the questions that are in the chat, please? For Martin, you embraced Judaism somewhat later in life. What compelled you to do that and why then?
Yes, in 2008, when I was 55 years old, I became a bar mitzvah boy after 20 months of study at Temple Sinai in Washington, D.C. It was basically a way, it was something not too far removed from my books, which have been attempts, obviously, to tell the story of my family, but also an attempt to reach back through the generations to be in touch with them, to learn what I could about them. And becoming a bar mitzvah was also a way of reaching back to the generations, knowing that, for instance, on Yom Kippur, when the cellist begins playing the Kol Nidre. It's the same melody that my grandfather heard and my uncle heard. And so it was a continuation of this effort to learn what I could about my vanished family.
Another question says, Martin, in the film, you seem very angry with your father. Did you ever resolve that anger with him while he was still mentally intact?
Resolve. I think I came to terms with it. I discovered it. I think I learned its source. As I discussed earlier, it was a combination of frustration, anger, and pity for him. So I think to the degree that I understood those feelings, that was a step towards resolving it. I'm not sure I did before Alzheimer's overtook him. I'm not sure I have done it entirely to this day, but I guess I hope there's still time.
All right, question for both Anders and Martin. Anders, you mentioned the strong response for 2 weeks of the film in Germany before COVID hit. What accounts for that strong reception in Germany? Can that be called generational in terms of the often seen sharp differences between those who lived through the Nazis and those younger who mostly reject the guilt, and even younger generations of Germans who seem to want to know and understand what Germans have wrought? What do you think?
Yes, broadly so. I don't think it's true that a whole generation has rejected the guilt. I think if anyone, it was the first generation who maybe had to reject the guilt to move on in any way, or who found it has the most guilt to reject, so to speak. I think I've seen, it's like it has grown and peaked around the tooth as of the millennium, as around in the late 90s, with the reunion of Germany, there was a re-examination, and that whole process became a very big thing that kind of peaked, say, 10, 15 years ago, and have made, kind of cleared the desk about, have made anything possible to discuss, removed many taboos, but also allowed people a more, what should I say, confident approach to the topic. Time helps, of course, also. But I think what is striking, the sense, the feeling I get from these screenings in Germany is that it's in a whole different way perceived as a family event, because the Holocaust, in a German perspective, was essentially a fratricide, a murder on a family member. Mm. Because in the Ashkenazi German thing is so, goes so deeply back to the Middle Ages and to the formation of Germany as a culture at all. It goes back to those cities along the Rhine where town culture in the German tradition evolved. You cannot simply not separate the Jewish from the German in its culture history. And it's that kind of intimacy that I sensed around the film, not observing a guilt from a distance, but trying to sort out a family tragedy more than anything.
Martin, your response to that question?
I defer to Anders. He lives there much of his time, and I'm not quite sure I'm really in a position to judge generationally. I do recall that in the late 90s, when I began going to Germany fairly regularly to do research for the Inextinguishable Symphony, there was a time when a youngish author in his early 40s, I guess, had received some national book award. And in his speech, accepting the award, he declared that it was time for his generation to, as he put it, cast off this hair shirt that we've been forced to wear for so many years. And we want to move on. But I defer to honors as far as the situation today is.
Well, so this is still very much a shirt they wear. Generally, of course, you'll find minorities, you'll find radicals reject the whole thing, and you will find ignorant people who will simply not begin to understand what happened. But if you look at the mainstream media, middle class approach to the subject, no, it's very much, that shirt is very much still on. I just find that they can kind of approach still at the same time, approach it in a more confident and free-minded way, if that makes any sense. They can. That's a new and more liberal, free approach to the subject.
Martin, what did your brother think of the book and the film, and your children, his children?
Well, alas, my brother died 10 years ago.
Oh, sorry.
So he could not see the film. He was very supportive when the book came out. He and I both sort of landed in the same professional pool as classical music announcers, presenters at public radio stations, I in Washington, he in Buffalo. And he arranged a very nice event in Buffalo when the book was published. So he was very supportive. And those of you who have read the book know that he was with me in a very important moment in 1999 when we first discovered the graves of Moses and Levi Goldschmidt in the ill-kept Jewish cemetery in Sachsenhagen, the little hamlet where my grandfather was born. And he was with me on the memorial march through the streets of Oldenburg that takes place every 10th of November to commemorate the march through the streets of Oldenburg of Jewish men who had been arrested the night before on Kristallnacht. So he was very much a part of the ending of the first book.
Yes, it was inevitable. You would spend a life in music. You certainly don't have to be schooled on the power of music. It saved your parents' lives.
Literally and figuratively.
It literally did, and it. I think it infused the work I do with a certain gravity that doesn't. It's not always appropriate, perhaps, but again, as I wrote in the preface to the first chapter of the first book, my parents literally risked their lives sneaking through the streets of Berlin after curfew to play chamber music with their friends. And I think I learned that music can not only enrich your life, it's something that is sometimes worth risking your life for. So I think it's added a certain element to my work on the radio.
So did your father give up the thing that mattered to him most out of, I don't know, some kind of self-punishment?
Yes. That's my theory. And I gave him an early copy of the manuscript of the book to read. And I asked him about that theory of mine. And he said, I cannot disagree with anything you have written.
Wow. Because he says in the film, your script, that someone had to earn a living. And I was wondering if maybe it is economics, maybe.
Well, I think it's true someone had to earn a living, but you can earn a pretty nice living playing with the second oldest American symphony orchestra, which is the St. Louis Symphony Orchestra. I think he was rationalizing his decision.
Do you have another there, Dina?
Sorry there. Martin, do you have anger at your grandfather for putting the guilt he did on your father?
The guilt came from the letters that were written. As Bob Edwards said earlier, the St. Louis, the refugee ship on board of which my grandfather and uncle were. It was eventually sent back to Europe. My grandfather and uncle disembarked in France. And then just a short while later, when World War II broke out on September 1st, 1939, my grandfather and uncle metamorphosed in the eyes of the French from displaced persons to enemy aliens. And they were sent from one camp to another until in August of 1942, they were sent via the transit camp Drancy outside Paris to Auschwitz and their deaths. The second book that I wrote about my family called Alex's Wake, I followed in their footsteps to all of those French camps. And seeing under what circumstances they lived and reading firsthand accounts, I could not blame my grandfather for his sharp words in pleading with his son, my father, to do anything he can to get him and his younger son out of there. So I'm not mad at my grandfather. I mean, what he wrote was very harsh. He said, if you do not move heaven and earth to get us out of here, that's up to you, but it will be on your conscience, which is a pretty heavy thing to say and write. But given the conditions under which he was living, I cannot blame him whatsoever.
And it wasn't like your father did nothing. I mean, he came here to Washington, for example, and trying to see people to...
He did, but he arranged a meeting, but it wasn't until a couple of months after, it turns out, my grandfather was murdered. And he eventually, every now and then, he would send $25 via the Quakers to Alex and Helmut in their camps in France. But I think, and I'm not, I mean, my father probably did not do everything he possibly could have. And I think that's what led to his feelings of guilt.
All right, let's take our last few minutes here. Please, if you have any final comments that you would like to make about the film. I know it's been an extraordinary discussion. Let's start, Anders, let's start with you, please.
No, as I said, I'm still busy trying to understand the German-Jewish relationship. It's a topic that remains with me after all this. Is the mystery of George's insistence on being German and not a Jew, and whether this position has at all any validity today, or whether it is more like what Martin says, an expression of fear or guilt or induced by negative premise. Can there also be seen something positive been seen in, if you like, the attempt to suppress your tribal or original heritage in order to move for a citizenship of some higher order? And I think that was very much the mindset of Alex and George, was they were citizens in the German Republic, the Weimar Republic, which they saw as something that could, if not already was, a perfect civilization. And that is, for me, actually awkwardly an inspiration also in George's denial. At least it's a topic that keeps occupying me after having made this film.
Thank you. Martin?
I just really would like to express my profound gratitude to Honors for initially becoming interested in making the book into a film, and his extraordinary work in what he's done. And thanks to everyone who attended today. Thanks to you who have seen the film. And I hope at some point you'll be able to ask your friends to go see it at, I don't know, Bethesda Row or someplace.
Absolutely.
But thank you. Thanks to all. And thanks to my friend and former softball manager, Colonel Bob Edwards, for his great contribution.
Softball manager. All right. Bob, is there anything that you would like to add at the end of this conversation?
Honored to be in the company of these two wonderful storytellers and skilled artists. If Anders wants to make a film of the Alex's Wake, Martin's other book of his family, just get a big boat.
And if we have that opportunity to repeat this, Mr. Edwards, we will certainly invite you back as well.
Thank you.
So on behalf of all of us, thank you so much for this revealing and enriching look behind the scenes of a book, a film, and a legacy that have touched us all so deeply. Thank you in particular to Martin Goldsmith, Anders Ostergaard, and Bob Edwards for a masterful hour of conversation. Thank you to the Generations After Programs Committee for organizing this event, Ephraim Katsir for his technical support, and Menemsha Films for its collaboration in screening the film and for allowing us to extend that viewing for another day. Be sure to join the Generations After for our August 29th early fall tea and membership program. The topic will be rebuilding lives from DP camps to the United States and Israel. It will feature two expert historians, Dalia Ofer from Israel and Beth Cohen from the United States. Also, if you are not yet a Generations After member, not receiving our monthly newsletters with information on our programs and others of interest, please visit generationafterdc.com to join us. Good afternoon and see you all next time.
Thank you. That was wonderful. Thank you so much, all of you. It was
Thank you.
Completely fascinating discussion. And we can't thank you enough. It's wonderful.
Thank you.
Hope to see it on the big screen someday.
Yes, that would be great.
Yeah. All right.
Bob, before you leave, this is has nothing at all to do with this program, but it's suddenly struck me last night to ask you, did you know ahead of time that your voice would be featured in the last episode of The Sopranos?
Was it the last? I know there was...
The penultimate. Maybe it's the penultimate.
There's a scene where the FBI FBI agent is in the car.
Right, and you hear...
Yeah. I'm introducing the late great Margot Adler.
So did you know about it ahead of time?
No. And I wasn't paid for that, of course. And... I'm also in a Richard Gere movie. My high point of my career was being a clue on Jeopardy.
Ah.
And they got it. That was the, you know, if they hadn't gotten it, it would have been awful. You know, if nobody...
All right. Well, gentlemen, thank you both so very much. This has been a privilege and a pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Take care. Hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.